Thank you so much, Brother Gary. If you have your Bibles, please open them to 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. One of my favorite books in all the Bible, the last will and testimony of Paul the Apostle. They say a picture is worth a thousand words. And certainly in recent years we have seen some very vivid images of a quality that people talk more and more about in our day and time, and that is courage. I will never forget, as long as I live, that image of the day of the Tiananmen Square massacre when the Chinese students were crying out for freedom and for democracy, carrying around little statues they had made trying to imitate the Statue of Liberty, and camping out in Tiananmen Square as the army gathered. And initially the army wouldn't take any action. The Chinese had to bring in rural troops who had never been to Beijing before to get any kind of action. And I'll never forget that column of tanks moving into Tiananmen Square until one student just stood in front of that column of tanks, and the whole column of tanks ground to a stop. What an unforgettable image of one student's courage. Who will ever forget those vivid images from September 11 when the firemen and the policemen were running to the burning buildings of the World Trade Center while the vast throngs of people were running away from the danger. Yet those whose responsibility was for safety and security, many of them running to their deaths, were going as fast as they could to the damage, to the injured building. And who will ever forget, most recently, just a few weeks ago, those incredible scenes from Iraq on the day of their elections with those purple-stained fingers held high in the air, of men and women literally risking their lives, the lives of their family and children, their livelihood, to cast their vote for the future of their country, knowing that that purple stain might not only indicate them as someone who voted, but might also become a mark for death. Courage. It's such an important quality, and it's a quality that everyone in the gospel ministry, whatever that ministry may be, is going to have over the years of your life. For we live in a day when our faith is being challenged as it never was before. As a matter of fact, I would say that the 21st century is more like the first century than any other century of the church since the first century. For like the first century, we live in a world that says anybody's religion is fine as long as you don't say there is only one truth about God. We live in a day when people are being martyred for their faith. More Christians were martyred for their commitment to Jesus Christ in the last 100 years than in all the previous centuries of the church put together. We live in an age when it is once again dangerous to take a stand for Jesus Christ. We live in an age when it's dangerous to serve the Lord in the church without risk of being forcefully terminated or fired and being hassled and having your family face all manner of grief and suffering. For 89% of our churches are plateaued or declining. And whenever you go into a church and you try to get people motivated to change directions and to go a different way, well, that's a very dangerous occupation. If you've never done it, you will find out. And even in growing churches, you find out that some people aren't excited about growth. When new people come in and take their spot in their pew where they sat for the last 25 years, this is very upsetting and disturbing. Or when you want to redecorate the church and have to fight over what color carpet you're going to have, some pastors have gone down the tubes just over a simple discussion like that. Ah, that's why I'm not going to go to an existing church. I'm going to be a church planter, and I won't have to put up with all that foolishness from Baptists. Yes, that's right. All you have to do is go to a place where you've never been before and knock on hundreds and hundreds of doors, meet total strangers, convince them that Jesus Christ is the truth, the way for salvation, that He can change their lives, get them to come to church, start reading their Bible, and lost people love to do this. I tell you, they're just everywhere waiting for church planters to come and start a church in their community. And then you have the small little details of, will there be finances to feed you and your family? Will there be any kind of security in starting that brand new church in a place where Baptists have very little presence? I don't care who you are. I don't care what your ministry may be. If the ministry is counseling or music or working with children or working with adults or missionary work or being a pastor, whatever God has called you to do, courage is going to be an essential quality. Sometimes I wonder what in the world Southern Baptists were thinking about in 1917 when they met for the Southern Baptist Convention. Because it was in 1917 that Southern Baptists met, and for the first time in the history of the Southern Baptist Convention, they decided to start a seminary from scratch. And they decided they would put it in the city of New Orleans. What were they thinking? Five Southern Baptist churches in the entire city in 1917. Four of those five churches were missions, only one self-supporting church. What were they thinking? They were thinking that probably the best way to train people for ministry was to put them in a setting where ministry would have to take place every day they were in school. They decided that it would be great to train people for ministry in a place that would challenge them all the time, not just when they had a pop test or had to memorize Hebrew vocabulary words. They decided that it would be a great thing to have a seminary that was a lighthouse as well as a schoolhouse, and that students could best learn ministry by doing ministry. They put this seminary in this place to raise up a generation of God-called men and women with courage. Courage to go anywhere and do anything and seek out any opportunity God gave them to seek without fear or hesitation, because they knew in the hand of Jesus they were safe and secure. To raise up a courageous generation. And it is a challenge to develop that courage in your soul. I remember a few years ago when I'd taken a few students down to the French Quarter to do some street witnessing on the streets of the quarter. And whenever I did that, I would always stay in one place so the students could find me if they had any problems. And I was standing in the corner where I was supposed to be. And all of a sudden, one of our students just came running as fast as he could. I mean, at a dead run. His face was white as a sheet. His hair was flapping in the breeze. He was sprinting for his life. And he came running up to me, and he was just hyperventilating. He said, "Dr. Kelly, Dr. Kelly, Dr. Kelly." I said, "Just calm down. Just get your breath." And "Dr. Kelly," I said, "Just calm down." I said, "It's going to be okay. What's happening?" He said, "Well, I was standing there with my partner, and he was talking to somebody, got into a conversation. He was going through the gospel on a corner a couple of blocks over. I was just standing there with him while he was witnessing and praying for him, and a homosexual came up and propositioned me, and I didn't know what to do. I just dropped my tracks and ran." It is a place when courage has to be a part of the equipment. Well, the Bible tells us where courage comes from. The Bible tells us where you can expect to see God develop that quality of courage in you. And I thought we would learn what the Bible has to say about courage from the life of Paul the Apostle. Well, some of you are thinking that really isn't very fair. I mean, he was Paul the Apostle. The was his middle name. Now, you've got to be awesome when the is your middle name. He is the defining Christian of our whole faith. The man who wrote over half the New Testament. The man who honeycombed the Roman Empire with churches. The man who was so bold and courageous he would witness to Caesar himself at the risk of his life. Who of us will ever be as brave as Paul the Apostle? Well, there's actually no one better to learn about courage from than Paul the Apostle, because Paul was a man for whom courage did not come naturally. And God made it a point, as he inspired Paul and told Paul what to write, and what God chose to preserve for the church through all the ages, God made it a point to inspire Paul to tell us the reality of his inner life and soul. And the truth of the matter is, Paul was a man who got afraid, terrified, in his service to Jesus Christ. Why, when he was in Corinth sharing Christ, going door to door, starting a church in that most corrupt and toughest of all the ancient cities of that ancient world, Paul said to the Corinthians, "And when I was with you, I did not come with superiority of wisdom or strength or eloquence, declaring to you the testimony of God. I was with you in weakness and in fear, I was so afraid, I literally trembled when I went out to tell you about Jesus. That's not Paul the Apostle, that's Chuck McKelly. I mean, I can understand that. Paul, in Acts chapter 18, when he was telling us the story of what happened when he first came to Corinth, Paul admitted that he went to bed the night after Crispus, the leader of the synagogue, got saved and was baptized, that he went to bed afraid. So afraid that Jesus had to come to him in a vision in the night to help him overcome his fear of what the consequences were going to be after Crispus, the leader of the Jewish synagogue, got saved. Paul was not a man for whom courage came naturally. Paul was someone that God had to teach how to be courageous. And so I think he's a pretty good place to go if we want to learn how that quality of courage can develop in our lives. The place I find that has just been such an encouragement to me as I try to let God teach me courage is the end of Paul's life. We have it in 2 Timothy. As far as we know, it's the last thing that Paul wrote. When he wrote this letter, he said to Timothy, please try to come before winter. He did not think he was going to live through another winter. He was in prison in Rome on trial for his life. He was chained to a Roman guard with a piece of chain 4 feet long, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. He knew that the next step he heard in the hallway could be the steps of his executioner coming to take him away for his last walk. He knew he was coming to the end. And the end wasn't going to be having a heart attack while he was preaching in a church service. And the end wasn't going to be getting sick and having a constant parade of the people he was serving in ministry come by and tell their beloved pastor and church founder how much they loved him or praying for him as he gently, peacefully entered into death and the transformation into glory. He knew that his end was going to come, courtesy of a Roman battle axe cutting off his head. So what does Paul have to say? Let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 6. Paul said, I am already being poured out as a drink offering. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. And henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which Jesus Christ the righteous shall give me when I come into his presence. And not me only, but that same crown shall be given to all of those who love his appearing. I see several things reverberating over and over in that simple little train of phrases Paul puts together. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. That give us a hint about where courage comes from. It comes from obedience. Obedience to do that which God gives us to do. Did you notice Paul didn't say, I kept fighting? He didn't talk about looking for every fight he could have and the number of fights he had. Paul talked about fighting the good fight, the fight that he was given to fight. He talked about staying on the course that God gave him to walk. He talked about keeping the faith that had been entrusted to him. All that Paul did was in response of obedience to the direction of God. And that's where courage begins to come from. It is not something that we have, like you have brown eyes or blue eyes or blonde hair or black hair. It's not something that is a natural characteristic. It is something that comes as we obey and do the things that God wants us to do. I came from a large family. I have four sisters, no brothers. Even our dog was a girl. I had no chance at all growing up. And my oldest sister was several years older than I was, and she began dating the guy she eventually married when they were in the second grade. So all of my life, he was hanging around our house, literally all of my life. And he thought it was his personal responsibility to give me grief, to hassle me. He would tickle me. He would beat me up. He would inflict all kinds of pain and damage on me. I bear in my body the marks of things that he had done, scars that are here to this day, that he is responsible for inflicting on me. And I'll never forget, finally when they went to college, they got married. I was so excited, sacrificed a lamb, invited all my friends. It was a wonderful day in my life. They were gone. Well, they came back for a visit to see my mom and dad and the family one weekend, and by this time I was in high school, like a sophomore or so in high school, and they got in very late at night, like 2 o'clock in the morning. And they came in my parents' home, and my brother-in-law just dropped his suitcase as soon as he walked in the door, ran up the stairs, down the hall to my bedroom, threw open the door to my bedroom, jumped on top of me, and began to tickle me. It was 2 o'clock in the morning. I had no idea what was happening. All I knew is that something was going on that I didn't like. And without even thinking, I just picked him up and threw him against the wall. The rules changed. He never bothered me anymore. Here's the end of the story. I discovered I had a strength I didn't know I had. That's what happens in obedience. You learn things about you that you didn't know. But God knows. He is the one who formed you in your mother's womb. He was the one who gave you life, who gave you the personality you have. He gave you your gifts and your abilities. And when He gives you direction, it is in light, not of what you know about yourself. It's in light of what God knows about you. I have always been a very quiet, shy person. Always, for all of my life. Give me a book in a quiet corner, I'm a very happy camper. I am a quiet, shy person. So what did God call me to do in my ministry? He called me to be an evangelist and to spend my life with people I never met before and to learn how to do things like witnessing on the street and stuff like that. God has a sense of humor, but He also has a knowledge of me. And what I discovered as I became obedient to a call I didn't really understand, I found out I really enjoyed what God wanted me to do. Courage is the outgrowth of an obedience to the command and call of God on your life. And you have to come to the point in your walk with Him where you accept the fact that He knows you better than you know yourself. For He rarely calls us to the comfortable. He always directs us to the challenging, and He will put you in circumstances. He will lead you to places. He will ask of you those things you don't think you have the power to give. But He knows you better than you know yourself. Obedience is accepting that fact. Accepting the fact that what God wants you to do, He will enable you to do. And Paul said, I have fought the good fight. I think he said it not with a sense of pride. Bring it on, buddy. I still got some fight left in me. I think he wrote that phrase with a sense of amazement. I fought the good fight. I didn't quit. He said, I finished the course. Have you ever been to a race when they fired the starting gun for a race, a sprint, and the athletes just started running in every different direction? I mean, just imagine, everybody lined up at the starting line, and the starter says, on your mark, get set, go. And somebody runs that way, somebody runs that way, somebody runs that way. Run 100 yards, any direction you want to go. Is that the way it works? No, they always run the same direction. Because the goal is not to run 100 yards, the goal is to finish the course. What makes you think if we do that with our sport of track, sprints, and running, that God handles people in ministry any differently? It's not that you just go out and serve God. It's that you discover what God wants to do with your life and that you run the course He has laid out for you. I told you my calling was evangelism. It took me a while to believe that and accept that, but as the more I said yes and the more I began to do, the more I began to really enjoy it. And it started when I was in college, and I was involved as a staff member of the collegiate ministry there on my college. And I was going to dorms four nights a week, knocking on doors and doing Bible studies and sharing Christ with people, and got to see God do a great and a mighty work on our collegiate ministry campus as we were really evangelizing. Our campus led the nation in number of conversions through the BSU program. We're having a wonderful time, and I began preaching revivals and going around all over the place. Could I tell you stories? I've eaten in every Dairy Queen in the state of Texas, I'm pretty convinced, and all the stuff, I mean, and my wife will tell you that today I can tell you what fast foods are at every exit for a 150-mile radius of the city of New Orleans. Been there, done that, got the T-shirt from all of them. And God called me to evangelism, and I was doing revivals and having a great time with that, and man, it was so much fun. And then one day, the dean of the school stopped me on the sidewalk. I can take you to the very spot. I will never forget. I can take you to the spot. The dean of the school stopped me on the sidewalk and said, "Chuck, you're almost through with your dissertation. You'll be graduating soon, and we want you to stay and teach evangelism and be a seminary professor." I'd been in school for 25 consecutive years. Staying in school for any reason whatsoever was not on the agenda. I had started a five-year plan to be ready for full-time evangelism when I finished my doctoral work. And I was right on schedule. I'd formed a nonprofit corporation. I had a board of directors who were praying for me and supporting me. I was beginning to fill up my schedule with events based on the fact that I was going to be a full-time evangelist. Everything was cooking. I was right on schedule. I was going to be graduating soon, and I was going to be free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last, out of school. We want you to stay and teach evangelism. And I will never forget. I said, "No, I'm an evangelist." But I said, "I guess I'm obligated to pray about this, so dear God, my food is almost getting cold, but real quick, do you want me to be a seminary professor? Amen. Bless the food." That's about how much I wanted to pray about it. But a little tiny prayer. "I'm sure you don't want me to do this, but I need to be able to tell them that I prayed about it, so even though I know you don't want me to do this, do you want me to do this? I'm certain you don't, but I'd be interested in your opinion." God made it clear He wanted me to stay here and teach. It was one of the most depressing days of my life. And I said yes to Dr. Level, the president, and Dr. Coffin, the dean, and I went into depression. 30 years old, given an opportunity to teach on the faculty, one of the largest seminaries on the earth, is a great opportunity, most folks would say. But for me, it was the end of a dream. I'll never forget, I met with my board of directors, my board of trustees for my evangelism ministry. I wanted them to tell me not to do this. And I said, "The seminary has given me an opportunity to stay and teach, and all of you are here. You've been praying for me. We've been making our plans for evangelism. And I just wanted to run it by you guys. I know you probably think I really shouldn't do that. We're so close. Everything's going so well." And one by one, they began telling me why they thought I ought to stay and be a professor of evangelism. It was inescapable. But I was depressed. And I'll never forget. As soon as I turned in my dissertation, I hit the road, stayed on the road. I got back at 2 a.m. the day faculty workshop began, because that was as long as I could stay away. Went through faculty workshop, started classes, and it was about the second or third week when I was in the Breezeway classroom doing a class on the evangelism of Jesus, having a great discussion with the students, and all of a sudden it's as though I were out of my own body, looking down at that scene, and I realized that all of my life, God had been getting me ready for this. You see, this is the joy that you have. That the life you live is not an accidental life. It's not an accident of who you happen to know or what you happen to be good at. That in fact, God has a purpose for you. And you don't live just randomly doing something good for God. No more than a runner runs backwards from the 100-yard dash because he likes that direction better than forwards. You run the course of the purpose of God. and knowing that you were doing God's purpose for your life, that you were living out what the Lord of the universe created you to do, that is where courage begins to develop. Because you're not fighting a fight that you picked out. You're not running a race that you chose. You are doing what God Almighty said to do. And if God Almighty sent you at it, you know you're going to win. Do you know the perfect image? You remember the story of David and Goliath? When David, the young boy, came to visit his brothers who were soldiers in the army, and he heard the challenge of Goliath, all 10 feet of him, crying out, "Will anyone come and fight me? The winner of our fight will determine the winner of the war." And all those great soldiers with their armor and their weapons just sat there in fear and in silence, and no one responded. And David said, "I can do that. No problemo. I can do that. None of you guys want a piece of him? I can do that." And they told him to sit down and be quiet. And the king finally heard that David said he could do it. And he said, "You really want to try it?" David said, "Oh, no problem. No problem. Lions, bears, I've done that, been there, done that, got the t-shirt. Don't have a giant on the list. I'd really like to add a giant to the list. I can do that." He went out on the field of battle with the sling and his stones. Goliath insulted him. Goliath insulted God. And David said, "You're a dead man. God is giving you into my hands." See, it wasn't David's fight. It was God's fight. And whenever you're fighting God's fight, God has the outcome in hand. Another strand running through that wonderful string of phrases. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Is that strand of honor and stewardship. Have you ever noticed you'll fight harder when you're protecting something for someone else than you will for your own self? God has put in your hands what He wants you to do. He has given you the gospel, and you are the bearer of that gospel in the world. He has given you a challenge in which He wants you to share it. He may want you as a counselor opening the Word of God with hurting people to bring that gospel to bear when people say, "My life is falling apart, my marriage is falling apart," and that's the only thing that will open them up to Jesus. He may put it in your hands as a pastor who stands week by week behind the pulpit proclaiming the gospel of God, knowing that there are lost people who are there, there are saved people who are there who know lost people, and you're the one responsible for energizing the church to take this gospel throughout the whole community. Through your preaching of the Word of God, you may work with the children of the church and be raising up that next generation. You can't imagine how shocked and surprised the ladies of First Baptist Church, Beaumont, Texas, are that I'm a seminary president. They laugh every time I go home. You are the ones who are building into God's children the things that God will call upon them to have as adults. Every one of you are doing what God has enabled you to do. And it is a sacred trust. You're not doing it because you're good at it. You're not doing it because you want to do it. You're doing it because it is a sacred trust assigned to you by God. And Paul never got over that fact. He loved to describe himself as an ambassador for Christ. He loved to know that he was always the one representing God. His message was not his own. It's what God gave to him. And he said, "I kept the faith." All the opportunities I had to compromise, all the opportunities I had to give up, all the opportunities I had to say, "Well, never mind, even though I know they're heretics in the church, well, it's just not worth the hassle of confronting them." Paul said, "I kept the faith. All the passion of my being." And out of that sense of stewardship and responsibility, Paul found the courage was there for him to handle whatever life brought. Another strand of that was that sense of confidence in the outcome Paul had. Now, I want you to notice that in all those things, those three phrases, "I fought the good fight." Who won? There's no reference to that. You know, a lot of Paul's life, he looked like a loser. How many times did he get run out of town? How many times did his churches that he started erupt? in fights. What he said to the folks at First Baptist Corinth, they had to be Baptist. I mean, they had fellowship problems. They had problems with food. They had problems with doctrine. They had problems with sex or morality. They had to be a Baptist church. And Paul Watts, his church that he poured his life out for, just get messed up with so many problems. It'd be very easy to label Paul a loser. But 250 years after his ministry, and all those churches he planted and all those towns he got run out of, the Roman emperor knelt before Jesus Christ and declared Christianity to be the true religion. Paul didn't talk about outcomes in time, but he talked about the certainty of the outcome in eternity. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Nothing about outcomes there. But henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which Jesus Christ the righteous himself will award me. And Paul never lost sight of the fact that what happened here was not nearly as significant as what was already won and established there, because that was the true finish line. So the outcome of any particular battle was almost irrelevant, for the war was already over and the war was already won. That's what keeps you going through seminary, you know, because you know every semester will end. Every course will be over. And when you put enough of them together, there will be graduation. And there may be all kinds of hassles in between, but there will be graduation. And Paul knew that the crown had already been prepared, and all it was waiting was his presence and glory to be received. Well, those are some elements of courage. But what is the trigger that releases that courage in your soul? It comes from obedience. It comes from living that purposeful life. It comes from having that sense of stewardship and obligation. You've been given something to do by the Lord God Almighty. You owe it to God to do it. But what is the real trigger that pulls all those things together with that confidence in the eternal outcome that's awaiting us right now in glory? If you'll look over at verse 16, Paul gives us the real outcome. He said, "In my first trial, no one supported me. Everyone deserted me." And that precious little prayer, don't hold it to their account. Don't be mad at them, God, because they deserted me. But Paul said, in that first trial, I stood alone. No one supported me. Everyone deserted me. But what's next? But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me. Friends, Romans, and countrymen, lend me your ears. I need to bury an idea and not praise it. There is a direct relationship between the level of your intimacy with God and the level of courage in your daily life. Courage is ultimately the result of your conscious, intentional awareness of the presence of God in you, all around you, above you, through you, beneath your feet. It is when you have sight of the Almighty God that you will fear nothing. We sang that over and over in the songs that our praise team led us through. It is in that conscious awareness of God's presence that courage is ultimately released. And this is the fundamental basic task for everyone in ministry to do. The fundamental basic task. You must cultivate your intimacy with God. And you will have all kinds of challenges in preparation. You'll have wild and crazy days. You'll go to seminary someplace and you'll have professors. Why, they're going to think the only thing you do in your entire life, you are a full-time devoted student of their one course. And they will think that's what you do 40 hours a week. You study their one course because you love it so much. And you'll have six of them at the same time. And they will all believe that. And it'll be so busy and so demanding. And you'll have to work a job in addition to school, or maybe two jobs. Or your kids will get sick and there'll be no peace in the house for two or three nights on end and you're so tired. And all these little tests along the way are designed to see if you're going to choose to be in the presence of God. Whatever the circumstances, whatever's going on, you're going to choose to be in the presence of God. And that man, that woman, who keeps choosing the presence of God, whatever the circumstances of their day, that man, that woman will find courage matching whatever challenge presents itself. This is a day when the church needs heroes. The church needs men and women who will go to serve a church not because it's a good career move, but because you don't care what problems it has, you know God wants you to go in there and address them. This is a day when the church needs heroes who will be willing to go to dangerous places to take the gospel to people who have never heard. This is a day when the church needs heroes who would be willing to go to a part of the country that has very little influence of Christianity and start a church from scratch. This is a day when the church needs heroes who will sit down with people who have the most complicated problems in their life, and they will tell you all the things that are troubling them, and you will say to them, God has an answer, and that answer is Jesus, and here's how he can help you. This is a day when the church needs heroes. Maybe they won't have the stain of purple on their finger, but they do need to have the presence of God on their faces and intimacy with God in their hearts and an awareness of God constantly on their minds. For if you will do that, you will have courage and you will look back as that scaredy cat Paul did and not be embarrassed about your fear, because you will have a testimony of how God replaced the fear with courage. Don't even think about coming to this seminary if you're not ready for God to teach you courage. It's why we were put here. It's what we're about. It's the kind of circumstances that God's going to put you in. This is the place that God chooses to make a laboratory growing heroes. Would you join me for a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we are reminded often in this day of the courageous and of the heroic in the world. Our precious soldiers who are over there fighting for freedom and for democracy. Our missionaries, Father, we've had to bury far too many of them in the last few years. It is a day, Father, when courage is a necessity and not a luxury. There is no easy way to learn it. There is no easy way to get it. But every God-called man, every God-called woman, will have all the courage they need. So much courage, it will not be danger that is seen. It will be the presence of God that they see. And it will be his voice giving direction they hear, not the voices of enemies and conflict. Oh, Father, I pray for these precious men and women. I pray that you would give them guidance and direction about the course you want them to run, about the fights you want them to undertake, about the gospel you want them to keep faithfully. I pray, Father, that you would remind them of the glory that awaits, that we might truly see one day somebody look back on this generation and say, that was a generation of heroes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.